soldering our flight controller to our sub-250-gram drone, all that and more, this time on Hack 5.
Hello and welcome to Hack 5. My name is Darren Kitchen.
My name is Shannon Morse.
It's your weekly dose of technolust, and we are very excited.
Why?
Because we're continuing our series on building a sub-250-gram quadcopter,
yeah!
Sticking it to the man, not registering our drones, having fun regardless.
That's right. Sorry our episode last week was so freaking long.
Yes, it was.
And
but
so it was awesome.
The week before that, because there's a lot of material here. We could
there
break it
time.
Up into little bits, but it would just
break
take
it into
5,
the entire season of season 20.
No.
No?
It's season 20, episode 3. Not 2003, which, by the way, was the year that the best Unreal Tournament came out. No, it's not 2004. Just letting everybody know. All right, but you didn't tune in to hear about my gaming nostalgia. You wanted to know about how to continue building the quadcopter.
Yes.
If you've been following along here, you'll notice that we have da-na-na-na. What is currently
A half-built
quadcopter.
Quad.
210 millimeters rotor to rotor, and this guy is a very generic kind of quadcopter build that goes over some of the basics that you can apply to really any build, and we're going to continue on today. We've already put in, if you're just tuning in, we've already attached to the frame our power distribution board, mm-hmm. our electronic speed controllers, and our motors. We do not put the propellers on until right before we're about to take flight, because later tonight we are going to get these guys spinning and we don't want to chop off our fingers, which is fun. The next step is to get into our flight controller.
Yes.
Check this bad boy out. We have here a NAS 32 version 5. I know the version 6 is out. I've heard conflicting reviews. I'm staying on 5 for the time being, but you can tell me in the comments why 6 actually isn't that terrible. And so we're going to get this guy soldered up. We're going to get him placed onto our board.
Awesome.
And then we're going to add the rest of our components. So namely, our satellite receiver here. We're using a Lemon RX. You could also use an Orange or many other satellite receivers just because it's very small and lightweight. And additionally, we're going to go ahead and wire in a buzzer as well as the battery voltage meter on this thing. So we're going to be glossing over some of the features of the NAS 32 with the software that we're going to load onto it.
But we'll go into those deeper in a future episode, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Right now, we're just focused on getting the basics going so that we have stable flight. And then based on the interest, if there's like, hey, everybody wants us to go into these parameters or those, we can do follow-ups because the rabbit hole goes pretty far.
Okay.
All right. So first up, we need to get our ESCs. As you see here, we have all of our electronic speed controllers just electric taped with red electric tape.
Right.
Ooh, pretty. To the centers of our arms. And that's just temporary. We're going to pretty this up later. And we'll notice that while we have all of the wires here actually wired in, we have, you know, the negative and positive going from our power distribution board to our ESCs, and then we have the power wires for the motors going in to the motors, obviously. The additional cable that's coming off our ESCs here is basically the black one is ground and the white one is signal. And so this is how the flight controller is going to signal to each ESC what to do.
Okay.
So we need to wire those into our flight controller, the NAS 32, on these pins up at the top here. And so to make this easier, we're going to be using this little breakout pin here.
Yeah.
And what this will do is allow us to get a nice little 90 degree action off the side there. And what will happen is each of these will just slide
Very
on
cool.
like that. Now, I will say we may follow up and actually go back and remove this because we are going for as light as possible.
Right, of course.
And this is, if we bring out our scale and take a look here. Come on, boot up. There we go. We're wasting 1.4 grams.
Wow, that's a lot.
It adds up. And also, you know, you have to consider the little tiny connector at the end of these servo wires. So, you know, whatever that comes out to, we could probably be talking about another 2 to 3 grams here. Mm-hmm. So we may loop back and do that because if it comes down to it and we need an extra 3 grams, we can always remove these.
Okay.
But I just know from experience building something similar to this that we can get away with leaving these. And what that does is it means that when we tear this thing apart, because you will tear this apart, or when you crash, because you will crash, we are going to have the opportunity to just put this back together quite easily, or salvage this and turn it into a different project, because this could support six motors if we wanted to have a hexcopter.
Ooh, how fun.
Later down the line.
Or a tricopter.
We could do the tricopter. Yes, we could. So, with that, let's go ahead and get soldering.
Okay, let's do this.
So, I'm just going to go ahead and show you what I like to do, which is get my little second set of hands going. And
second
I'll just
hands.
Go ahead and... You want to grab that guy?
No.
No? Okay.
Okay, hold on.
Thank you.
There you go.
All right. So, I've gone ahead and just pushed it in. Pushed in the little guy. What I like to do is kind of pull these apart ever so slightly so that you've got like a little bit of grabbiness to it.
Okay.
Then slide that guy in there and flip it upside down and it shouldn't fall apart. Now notice on the ends of here I've actually put a little electric tape, and that's so that, you know, we're not being really hurdy, I think that's the right word, to the components. And this end right here doesn't have any like resistors or something popping off at the top, so that's the end that I'm going to grab just lightly on the side.
Okay.
So with that, I'm now set up to just go ahead and solder each of these points. So I'll just get a few of them going.
You are preheated, sir.
Thank you.
There's a bunch of solder for
you. All right. So I'll just go ahead across the top real quick. So I like to just first start out by getting a tiny dab there, and then I'll just press it to that pin, and I'll hold it there for a second until that pin heats up. And now, doesn't take much. Boop. There you go.
Beautiful.
That was it.
That was great.
So you just do that.
Okay, so this has now been soldered to all the different ports. I know. Very clean job, isn't it?
I think it's not bad. It's not bad. And the reason that we're doing this is because inevitably you will crash, or you will want to recycle this flight controller on a different small unmanned aerial system, drone, quadcopter, multi-rotor, model aircraft. And so with that, having these pins does make it a lot more convenient. And what will end up happening is, if you take a look at the servo leads coming off of all of these different electronic speed controllers, they're just going to go ahead and plug right into these ports.
Cool.
So that makes it a lot easier. We could save a few grams by soldering directly on. And we've done the same thing on this side here, where we have the connectors for our battery voltage, our buzzer, and telemetry.
Okay.
That telemetry thing is interesting. It's for if we're using Firsky, and that brings us to our receivers.
All right.
Here's a receiver, and here's another receiver just like it on another similar board that I've done before. And these are satellite receivers for spectrum primary receivers. So let me explain this. There are basically two different major protocols that you find in the world of model aircraft.
Okay.
And that is Firsky or Fry, or however you pronounce that, I don't know, or Spectrum. And it's kind of like Xbox 360 versus versus PS4.
Spectrum sounds like it should be like a Firefly knockoff TV show. And if you get that, good for you.
Okay. Well, with that, I would say that I prefer Spectrum, but it's up to you. For this, we're going to be using Spectrum, but both of them, what we're looking for is not to use the actual Spectrum receiver, but rather the satellite. So check this out. This is your typical Spectrum receiver. This is a six channel, right? And so what you typically have here is you have, you know, an antenna, and then you'll have another antenna there for diversity, and then out of this you will get ports for your throttle, your aileron, your elevator, your rudder, gear, and an auxiliary, and then you'll plug in a bunch of these different, if I plug it in the right way, you'll have these different servo leads that will plug into these here. Well, here's the thing. This thing is huge, and what we don't want
is
six.
Too.
We don't want six of these coming off of it and going to our board, because that's going to add a lot of weight, and it's also pretty huge. So the other receivers that you'll also typically find are ones like this. Here's a...
Oh, boy.
This is not a tricopter. It's a quadcopter that had a bad accident, and,
wow.
And the reason is right here, but that's a story for another time.
Jeez.
Anyway, look at this component right here. This is another Spectrum receiver, and this is an 8-channel. As you can see, it's massive, but look at this wire coming off the side.
Yep.
So that is a Molex cable that's going to just run to our satellite receiver. So it's the same cable that's connected to this guy right here. And what that will do is add diversity. So if I pulled this out, here we go. Come on.
It's the same kind of Molex, yep. Isn't it?
And plug this into here. What that'll let me do on this quadcopter is, you know, as you can see, I have little antenna right there, mm-hmm. right? But now I can take this and I can put it on the end of one of the arms, right? Or somewhere far away from any potential sources of electromagnetic interference, such as the propellers, which will give me a better strength receiving, which
That's
will
cool.
allow me to have longer range. Uh-huh. Now, since we're making a medium range craft, we really don't care about that. And also, since we are since we're concerned about the size and the weight, we're going to use just the receiver.
Okay.
And what's really nice is that we can actually use just the satellite in this case. So we can wire this directly into our flight controller so that they become best friends. This will act as the primary receiver in software and then just communicate over that serial line to here.
That's cool.
So really it's just a matter of first binding this mm-hmm. with a real receiver.
Okay.
Right? And then once it's bound to your controller, we'll be able to then solder it directly onto this guy. Now, for all intents and purposes, that has already been done. However, we will loop back around on that in a separate segment.
Okay.
But suffice it to say, what we'll get out of this is we'll be able to take just this 3-pin serial lead, and we'll be able to solder it now right onto the board. And
okay,
that will make these guys happy.
Yay.
So, this actually brings up a little bit of a frustration with many things in the world of RC. And that is, if you look at the colors on this serial cable.
Oh, I know what you're going to say.
Mm-hmm. You'll notice that we go from gray, black, to I guess it's orange or yellow.
Yep.
Here's another identical one that I've done in the past.
I have the same issue with Arduino motor components.
This one goes yellow, black, red. Well, obviously the red, and I can follow the line, is our voltage line, and it's on the very end. And that means that if you were able to flip this somehow, you could burn out your board.
I would Thankfully, assume black is always ground.
Black is always ground, and then in this case, in this one's case, the yellow is the signal.
Okay.
So on this one, the white is the signal. It's a little frustrating, but so just pay attention to the wiring guide on your particular unit, because these colors are not always going to match up with what you expect.
Okay.
So. What we'll do is we will cut this cable and then wire it directly into the pins on here. And they're really tiny pins, but I'll show you where they go. So let's get to that. For that, we will once again get this in here. So I would say what I'd love to do is actually put this on top. Since it's already in a case. Now we could take off the case and we could save a gram.
Yeah.
Or we could leave it in the case and we can just put it right on top and it's not going to interfere with anything.
Right.
And that way we get a shorter cable and less mess inside of our fuselage.
Okay.
Alternatively, we could put it at the end of the fuselage, which may give us slightly better radio performance, but I don't think anything significant. The only concern with doing this is if we have the vertical room. Because remember, we're trying to get this to go as 15 millimeters. And already looking at this, I'm afraid that we've already kind of screwed ourselves over by putting this
we
on.
We have.
You think?
Yeah. Okay, so we soldered all the joints onto our flight controller, but
one might say we did a wax on.
We did a wax on. Wax off.
And then we did a wax off.
So it doesn't fit. It's a little bit taller than what Darren prefers.
Yes.
So we unsoldered all of the joints on here and we're going to wire them all separately.
Well, we mainly did this for two reasons. First of all, I want to emphasize how important it is to test fit all of your components and to measure twice and to solder once. Secondly, Shannon decided that she was going to get into the hobby of making electronics jewelry, which is why we are now the proud owner of this Flying Spaghetti Monster-like disaster. So
that was all you.
Don't disaster
that was all
like
your
we disastered.
Choice. That was all you.
And the reason for this is, and there's really nothing wrong with going this approach. In fact, for your first build, you probably want to, but because I am so particular about really, really, really wanting to be able to build this with 15 millimeter standoffs instead of the 35 millimeter standoffs, we don't have a whole lot of vertical room on our fuselage.
Okay, so moving on.
So much so that we're going to have to just go ahead and so what that means now is instead of plugging these in, we're actually going to run them perfectly to where they need to be, and then we're going to snip them and solder them directly to the board.
Okay.
And this means that we'll have nicer cable management. We won't have, you know, bunched up cables hanging out in the front of our fuselage or anything, which will be really nice. So this will end up being a prettier build, if not a little bit more complicated. But we're saving weight, and that brings us to our receiver, which we're going to do the same thing to.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and cut this cable and solder the receiver directly onto the board, because it is in fact with the case with the NAS 32 version 5 that there is not a pinout to be able to just plug this in. I wish you could just take that Molex and directly plug it into something. It's not the case. We're going to have to solder, I believe, ground here, signal here, and voltage there. And it's kind of a pain, but let's get started. So since this is the front of the quadcopter going that way, mm-hmm. we only need, and we're going to put this in the back somewhere. The cable length, I'm going to assume that will be enough.
Okay.
Yeah. So we'll just make it work.
Okay.
So remember, measure half, cut twice. There. So cut that out.
That's quite
That
a
goes
bit.
Into our savings pile.
Okay. Along with our flying spaghetti monster.
Yeah. So what is the other, where is it? I have to remember the pinout now because this one is crazy. So yellow is red.
Okay.
Black is black. White is yellow. Okay, so let me do.
White is yellow.
Let me do white first. And it goes on pin 4 on the bottom. All right. I know, I'm trimming after I soldered, but it's not gonna matter, because this is just tinning it. And I just wanna shorten these, because I don't want any possibility of shorting out the board, since all of the little pads are very small. These are all gonna get soldered again, essentially. So the white one goes on. I check this guy for reference.
Four.
Pin 4. So first let me heat up pad number 4. It's really interesting, the just different techniques that you and I have. Like, you pull off a thingy of solder, and I always just use it off the reel. Okay. I have it coming out to the inside, which will make it easier because this is going to go that way.
Okay.
Now, the next one is the center pin, which is black. And so the black goes to on the other side of the board. This pin right here, the very last one,
okay.
next to the one with the dot. So it actually doesn't have any sort of indication whatsoever, which is a little annoying. But we will make it work. So first, put some solder on that bad boy. Come on. Great. Not too much because it's right next to these little resistors. Awesome. And now finally, yellow is our voltage plus. And that needs to go to this pin right here.
Oh, okay.
The one on the right that says 3V next to it.
Yep.
I believe that's right. Let me check my reference. Yes, it is. And this is the worst because it's next to an LED. It's so tiny. And you'll notice something. Because they're so spread apart, our yellow wire is actually too long. And rather than looping it back around,
yeah.
I'm going to say we should trim it up so it's just the right size. So right around here, I'll go ahead and snip that. Now let me get a little bit of solder on that 3-volt line. There we go. And once more, I'm going to trim this down. All right, we have completed soldering on the serial cable to our NAS32 board for our receiver. And the next steps now are, in fact, actually, before we even get to that, if I just test fit this on here, you'll see we've got a perfect pigtail that's going to allow us to plug the receiver in at the back of the unit, which will be cool. Nice. It'll get pretty good reception. And then one thing to note about that is what I'll want to do is actually zip tie this cable down at the back there, and that's going to prevent this from yanking off those connections. I've also gone around and put a little dab of hot glue on these pads.
And that was after checking for continuity with the multimeter.
Yes. Checking with continuity with the multimeter is just a good thing to do all around whenever you do the soldering.
Yeah.
And so I'll show you basically what we did here is we set our multimeter over to continuity. And you notice that when we press these two together, it chirps. So for example, over here, doesn't matter which one, this is negative on the left side and this is positive over here, but when we touch these together, it doesn't squeak because they're not connected. And that's good because otherwise we would be letting lots of magic smoke out today. And we've done the same thing with our flight controller board over here.
Okay.
So with that happy, the next steps, before we go ahead and actually mount this guy and start soldering on our speed controllers, is to understand the fact that in addition to soldering on our speed controllers, there are a few different accessories.
Yeah.
We have a buzzer, right? And that's just a little, it's a speaker that's going to solder on. And that's really useful because we're going to be able to have the flight controller communicate with us through different chirps, different statuses.
Hey, your battery's low. Beep, beep, beep.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
We'll also want to solder on the main battery source from the power distribution board so the flight controller knows how much voltage we have.
Oh, okay.
Our pack, say a 3-cell pack, as an example, would start at, well, it's 3 battery. Well, each cell is 4.2 when it's full, 3.7 nominal, and I say you better be on the ground when it's 3.3. Otherwise...
Yeah, you did that math 2 weeks ago?
Yes.
Okay.
So at 4.2 volts on a 3-cell, you'd have 12.6 total.
Okay.
And then when you're depleted, you'll be somewhere around, I don't know, 10.2.
Yeah.
Or 10 even, when you really should be on the ground.
Okay.
Otherwise, if you keep going, the battery will die and you will be on the ground whether
crash.
You like it or not.
Okay.
So to prevent that, we're going to tie the positive negative from our main power distribution board into the flight controller. So it always knows the voltage and then you can use the buzzer to start squawking at us and saying, hey, I'm out of juice, which is kind of what the telemetry stuff would do, but we're not doing telemetry on this build.
Okay.
And then what else? And then finally, we need to solder some wires onto this that will provide 5 volts to the board to power it.
Duh.
Okay. And so what we'll end up with here, if we look at this across, is if we look at the underside of this, they're labeled. So this is pins 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah.
And we'll just call that 6, right?
Okay.
So this set of pins right here, 1. They have a negative, which is on this first row, a positive in the center row, and a signal. The nice thing about that is if you accidentally swap your connectors one way or the other, since positive is always in the center, you're not going to accidentally short out your board.
Well, that's
good. Kind of a handy feature. So what we'll end up doing is soldering on all of our electronic speed controllers to ports number 1, 2, 3, and 4. Right? You'll notice something about these, though. If I compare these two servo leads...
Different colors.
Well, not only different colors, as they're always doing that to
us. Oh, that one only has 2, doesn't it?
It only has 2. And if you look at where those 2 are, it's at the top and the bottom.
Wait, so
what it's providing is signal and ground.
But you don't need power.
We don't need power. Because all of these, the only thing that these ESCs need is signal of like, hey, here's what I want you to do.
Yeah.
But because of that, this is called a BEC, or a battery eliminator circuit, is some electronic speed controllers will actually have that center line, will actually have the voltage line, and will provide typically 5 volts back to the flight controller to power it.
Okay.
Which is really convenient, except not in this particular case.
Gotcha.
So for that, we need to provide 5 volts on any of the free lines. And in this case, the next logical one would be, since we're using 1, 2, 3, and 4 for
five.
The motors.
Yeah, just put we'll it on pin 5.
Yes, and there won't be a signal because it's just dumb voltage. So we need to give 5 volts into voltage plus and ground.
Okay.
So we'll get that voltage plus and ground actually from right here on our board. So when we were talking about this power distribution board last week, I noted that it has a, in addition to just being a stupid simple thing that allows us to connect our positives and negatives, it has a few extra pins. You'll notice those plus and minus right there.
Yes.
And right above there, or is it over here? Yeah, it's over. It's under the wires so you can't see. But right over there it says 5V.
Okay.
So that's our 5 volt line, and then over here we have 12V. So we're probably not going to use those right now. We'll come back around when we add our FPV gear and our cameras and such, we'll use this. But for right now, we have these available.
Okay.
So we'll go ahead and just pull any wire. And what's really nice is since we cut this off of our radio, since we didn't need this much cable, and we saved
a
bunch of weight.
We can reuse that.
Yeah.
Yay, recycling.
So yeah, reduce, reuse, recycle.
R-E-C-Y-C-L-E, recycle.
Yes, and with our powers combined, we are Captain Planet.
Hack 5.
I'm going to give you a little tip here.
Okay.
I've got my battery plugged in.
Yeah.
This is about the length that I'm going to want because, as you can see here, it goes from, it's going to be from about here, and then it will go to the top.
Oh, it goes on the top.
Right.
Gotcha.
So now I need to trim the wire.
Okay.
How do you trim the wire, Shannon?
You cut it.
Not with the battery on it.
Oh, no. Not with the battery on it.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Yeah. Because you'd be bridging the circuits once you get into the center. Oh, yeah. Good stuff.
Yeah.
Don't let out the magic smoke. So. Do you want to solder this one?
Sure.
Okay.
Anywhere, where do they go?
Anywhere on the negative and positive line.
Oh, okay. I'll just stick them in the center.
Mm-hmm.
Center works, right?
The center works.
You're not
going to
stick
fine.
Anything else on there.
Nope.
Okay.
So just go ahead and tin those.
Tinks. Where's that extra little solder? There it is.
And I will figure out how long we're going to need to get from 5 volts to over here. And I think we're just going to run it along this and loop back around on number 6. And we could solder it to the bottom to save even more room, but you know. You know. You know.
You know.
Don't you know?
Don't you know? House.
Okay.
Russia's in near my house.
I would say you solder on that while I solder on this, but that's not going to work.
Well, you can get my solder gun if you want it.
Nah, it's okay.
No glasses, I'm dangerous. Okay. I need to spread these a little bit more. There we go. Can I just solder it straight on?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. You has no issues?
I has no issues.
There's already solder on there, so I think that's
enough. Did you tin the wires?
Yeah.
Then you should be all set.
You should check the
continuity?
Yeah.
All right.
Still good?
Still fine.
Excellent.
All right.
Yay!
Yay! We still need to do these.
Okay.
So
let's do them.
That's going to be the same thing, but it's going to. Oops.
Hang what on. Did you do?
I didn't. No, it's fine. It's fine. It's a good oops. These are going to be tied into this battery voltage plus and minus right there.
Okay.
Okay. And then this positive and negative 5 volt is going to get tied into here.
Oh.
So we need another length of
I see.
Our red and black
okay.
cable, which is where? Which is right here. And
that
speed.
Looks like Domokun.
Oh, I like that little avatar. What
Domoku.
Are they called?
I don't know. Okay. Avatars? A little bit more wire.
I'm not going to be using any of that. So, and we're not going to use the white line. Here we go. So these black and red. I'm going to go across here. And let's leave them like that for right now.
Yeah,
and then
I think that's a good idea.
Clip the length once we figure out
okay.
where our board's gonna be happiest. So, okay.
Yeah, that's, ooh, that was a lovely one. Good job, Shannon.
Way to go, Snurbs.
Go, Snurbs.
Or are you Snubs today? It's hard to keep track. Sometimes you feel like a Snurbs.
Snurbs. I'm a carrier, Snurbs.
Sometimes I don't. This is our just straight off the battery line that's gonna get soldered onto our battery, plus and minus. I think what we can do is actually put on the top nuts now.
Okay.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's great.
So now, let's take this battery voltage plus and minus line.
Okay.
And tie it in to...
Goes over here, right?
Let's look at this one. It goes to the very end. Yes. Goes to the end ones. And then next to that will be the buzzer.
Let me see.
And it's labeled.
VBAT. Oh, yeah. Okay. With plus on the inside, minus on the outside.
Correct. And that's typically how these go, actually, is you normally have minus on the outside for whatever reason. I forget. I think it's so that you don't accidentally do something bad.
Okay.
So these are going to be really tight because they're so close to each other. So.
That's fine. I can do
it. Is this still going? Okay.
Yeah.
Or you can.
I can do it.
All right. Go for it. And as long as we're doing that, we might as well also put on the leads for our buzzer. So our quadcopter can buzz out loud. You see what I did there?
I totally see what you did there. It's going to solder right on there?
Yeah, you know what? Let's use some heat shrink. Da-da-da-da.
Yeah.
And because I don't care about picking out the right color of heat shrink, let's use clear. My favorite color is clear. Throw on a little bit of heat shrink. Y'all like that heat shrink?
Y'all like that heat shrink?
And then throw on another fan. Blast it with your mom's hair dryer.
Beautiful.
Yes, and so what'll happen is our buzzer is going to go ahead and plug in to these two.
Okay.
And then our voltage will plug into those two. So they're all going to be really close, so we just need to make sure that we're precise. And this is why using the breakout pins makes things so much easier.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't take the easy route here.
No, we didn't.
We took the trying to keep it really lightweight route. So let's see what we can do.
Okay.
Great ideas start with great domains, like domain.com. That's a fantastic site where you'll get affordable, reliable, and easy to use domain discovery. It's the reason why Shannon and I love using them. And guess what? They love Hack 5, so they've got a hookup for you guys. When you use coupon code HAK5, you get a nice 15% off your orders over at domain.com. And you know what? Be sure to tweet them at domain.com and say, hey, thanks for supporting the show. So when you think domain names, think domain.com. As you can see here, we've gone through the process of, instead of putting on these pin headers, gone ahead and soldered all of our ESC leads straight to the board, so we're saving a lot of weight here. We're not going to have those little pin headers, we're not going to have the little servo connectors. We're going to save a couple of grams that way. This is, we're showing you now, because we just did all of that
work. We just flash forwarded into the future.
And lost the footage, but
and
that's
lost
okay.
The footage.
But essentially, you can see we did that. And so I say those look pretty great, except for one little problem. See,
yeah.
This little piece of equipment, very important here to test continuity every time that you do that soldering. So when I touch these, they are supposed to beep. And if I touch, say, negative and positive on this power distribution board, it will not beep because we don't want negative and positive to touch each other.
Right.
Now, the signal and ground wires for each of our electronic speed controllers, however, as you can hear, are touching.
Which means that they are crossing
yeah.
the streams.
You never want to do that.
No.
So
what do we do now?
Well, it's a great reminder of why two is one and one is none. Thankfully,
uh-huh.
we were smart enough to get some extras so we can go ahead and just tear into these. And now we get to start all over.
So but since we didn't have the footage, I guess it's a good thing we had a second one.
It is good that we have a second one because we'll have to do it again. And I think that we wouldn't have had this problem had we not put the pin headers on and then tried to take them off later.
And then turned our own jewelry piece of a flying spaghetti monster torn out. Yeah, that was not
yes.
fun.
Now we could probably go through with a microscope and find exactly where this is, but for time, we're just gonna switch over to this flight controller.
Okay.
And everything will be fine. We will be doing that next week, so between now and then, we'll get everything back to where it is now.
Okay.
And then we'll be ready to flash the firmware, get the motor spinning.
Yay!
And get to calibrating all of that, because we're so close.
Make sure that the motors are spinning the right way.
That's always important.
So software. Okay, yeah. Cool. I'm excited to check out what kind of software you've chosen for this. I'm assuming it's open source.
Yes, it is.
Awesome.
It's good stuff.
Very cool.
So let us know your thoughts, feedback at hack5.org, comments below. We're very excited to hear what you guys think of building your own quadcopter drone mania stuff.
And if you had joined us during Pentest with Hack 5 this previous weekend, thank you so much. I hope that you had a wonderful time, and we will be having other Pentest training courses in the future, so keep an eye on pentestwithhack5.com for those details.
Yes, and you can find all of the shows that we do here over at hak5.org or on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/hack5. Subscribing, liking, sharing, all of that goes a long way to helping support the Technolust.
That's right, it does.
And if you got a few bucks that are burning a hole in your pocket and you want to get some fun hacker gear, we make and sell those. So hakshop.com is the place where you can find all of our bespoke hacking gear.
Bespoke. Oh, that's so cute.
Yes, it's handcrafted, organic, free-range, fair trade Wi-Fi
nice.
Pineapples.
Very cool. Yeah.
I've got the certifications to back it up.
Oh, Lordy.
With that, I'm Darren Kitchen.
I'm Shannon Morse.
Trust your Technolust.
You like my new specs?
Yeah, no, they're spectacular.
Spectacular. Huh? They're legend. Wait for it.
Actually just did the Konami code, and now it's recording. I just did the Konami code. That's the trick.
Yeah.
You can't just hit start. You have to do up,
you
up, down,
do
down,
code.
LR, LR, BA, uh-huh. Then select, then start. The Zotter Sucker 5000!
My favorite was the cat lady. I forget her name, but she always went, ah!
I like to Moobix Moobix. I like to Moobix Moobix. I like to Moobix Moobix. No.
We have soldered all the points. Look at them all. They're so beautiful.
It's true, they are.
Dude.
It's the Flying Spaghetti Monster, isn't it?
It's the Flying Spaghetti Monster, yeah.
See, we're just making jewelry on this show.
Dairy.